Mr. Leongro, if you can just give a brief overview on GURA and some of the programs they operate, and then we'll move ahead into the nature of the indictment, not really focusing on the criminal aspect, but the impacts that it has had on the agency and what is put in place for the future to ensure that this does not happen again. Okay, so just go ahead first, the programs that GURA has to offer.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. Thank you for this opportunity to assure the community that the programs that GURA administers are intact and they are being implemented. Our Section 8 program continues to assist over 2,000 families. Our latest report indicates we are assisting over 2,314 families. Of those, 73% of those families are working families, so it's not families taking advantage of Section 8 for a free ride. Almost three-fourths of those families are working families.
Pardon me, Mr. Duenas, could you speak a little closer into the mic? I can barely hear you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's a talk softly and say nothing. As you know, we launched a lottery approach to our wait list earlier this year. We had selected over 1,800 families who had registered for the lottery. Of those 1,800 families, 1,271 completed the registration process successfully. And what you see there, our current number on the wait list is 1,426 families. Those include the families that were already on the wait list before we launched the lottery process. Okay. Most of these families are applying for the regular voucher, and then we have two special purpose vouchers that they also applied for. Those include what we call the non-elderly vouchers, non-elderly disabled vouchers, otherwise known as mainstream vouchers, for adults with disabilities. And the family unification program, which is aimed at or targeted at families that are under the services of a child welfare agency, in this case, BOSA within the Department of Public Health and Social Services. There are 20 families that applied for assistance on that wait list. One of the features of also in the Section 8 program is the Family Self-Sufficiency Program. This is a grant that we receive from HUD to help families improve their income, their ability to earn a living wage, and eventually get off the welfare programs. This is they sign a five-year contract, basically, and identify their individual goals that they want to pursue. Since 1997, 79 participants have successfully graduated. Last year, one individual graduated. This year, two individuals have graduated and have received escrow funds totaling $16,000 for both families. Part of the attraction for the program is that as their salaries increase, their rent will increase. But what we do, though, is take that increase and deposit it into an escrow account. So at the end of that five-year period, the family will have a little nest egg to pursue other things. Just last week, two of the families were recognized for completing their program, and they are also pursuing home ownership in partnership with the Micronesian Community Development Corporation. They are working with USDA and GURA to build 13 homes in the Sagan Bonita subdivision in Manila. Okay. Their monthly mortgage is projected to be about $600 a month, so it's a very affordable program. These families would be families earning 50% or less of area median income. Our public housing program, as of today, we have 715 families in the 750 units that we administer. About 67% of those families are working families. Again, I just wanted to counter the perception that these families are not are just sitting back. 67% or more than two-thirds of our families in public housing are working. And we will continue to encourage and assist those families. Let me just take one step back. Our family self-sufficiency program last year was amended to include families in the public housing program. So of the 120 current participants in the family self-sufficiency program, 99 are in the Section 8 program and 21 are in the public housing program. We also administer the Gumatran Kilidot program. Those are 49 units in Tumon for the elderly. They're 100% occupied at this point, and we have 40 families on the wait list. We receive a number of grants from HUD under the Community Development, Development Division of HUD, which includes the Community Development Block Grant Program, and I've listed some of the projects that are currently underway. We also receive, that's about $3 million a year. The Home Investment Partnership Program brings in about $750,000 a year. And you can see some of the programs where we are administering. These two programs are proposed to be eliminated under President Trump's 2018 budget. The President also proposes to reduce the appropriations for the Section 8 program and the public housing program. We are waiting until May 1st for more details from the President's budget to understand how much of an impact the reductions in the Section 8 and public housing programs will be. Right now, there are no firm numbers. Lastly, we have we administer the Low-Income Housing Tax Credit Program, which is a program under the Internal Revenue Service. We are responsible for identifying the priorities, housing priorities for the community, and awarding or developing a qualified application plan for which developers would then try and score as many points as they can to receive those credits. We allocate about $2.5 million a year in tax credits. For this year, we have awarded two developers tax credits. The first developer is Villa Del Mar. This is a 50-unit housing or 50-unit housing subdivision in the Tuolto area. They will be receiving about $2.5 million in credits. And then we are looking at awarding another $2.5 million in credits to the Summertown Estates 3 project. The Summertown Estates is better known to us as the old Lada Estates program. This 66 units will bring the total number of units developed under the Summertown Estates to the 399 units which were originally envisioned in the Lada Estates program. What we've done, as I said, we awarded about $2.5 million. We awarded the 2016 credits, as well as made a forward commitment for the 2017 credits. And that's how we were able to finance these two projects. The last page, Senator, you asked a question about how many elderly families are being assisted here on Guam. We've listed down all the tax credit projects that have been developed since 2005. There are, and looking at all the tax credit programs, there are 222 head of households age 62 and over in those programs. And the other column, which says total HH, actually refers to the number of seniors age 62 and over who are residing, not as head of households, but as members of those households. That we also list how many elderly that GURA is assisting. We are assisting a total of 511 households in our various programs, and we have about 49 individuals, the senior individuals in addition, as members of households in that are being assisted. So in total, we have 733 households that are being assisted through the tax credit or the GURA programs that are elderly, where the head of household is elderly. And another 480 individuals who are elderly who are living in households that are being assisted either in the tax credit or the GURA programs. I want to stress again, the programs are in place, they are being implemented. They are not directly immediately affected as a result of all the controversy that you see in the media.
I'll open up the questioning for my colleagues. Vice Speaker, Vice Chair, do you have any questions? Senator Tom, Ada?
Yeah, the question that I have is on this Guma Tranquilidad. I remember over the, past decade at least, there's been several attempts to try and basically lease that out and then take the lease income from that to possibly build another facility, similar facility, further inland. But there always seems to be a lot of pushback. Was that pushback from GURA, or where's that pushback coming from? Do you know?
I think Senator Argon says it's from him.
I'm raising my hand, good Senator Tom, because there's legislation that I did introduce that was fortunate enough to get the support of members of the legislature that will restrict that particular property specifically for our Manamkus. And the argument originated from many of the tenants as well as their family members that why is it that when we're looking at providing the best with the scenic view down there in the heart of Tumon, that we're even considering the possibility of relocating Manamkus, regardless as to whether it's inland, and you're providing them better accommodations. The Manamkus there insisted that they want to remain there and have access to the beach, have access to extremely valuable property. So that's one of the reasons why that legislation did receive the support it did. But I understand from an economic perspective, from a business perspective, you may think otherwise. For me, it's honoring our Manamkus, and that property was originally designated, identified for our Manamkus, and that legislation was passed. It does not restrict Guam Housing Corporation or Guam GURA from expanding the facilities there, but retaining it specifically for the use of our Manamkus.
That's what we're looking at, Senator. I think one of the residents best put it to me when I was talking to him. He said basically he had just moved in last month and he expects to die there. And so they do take a very strong concern about what's happening around them, and we have to respect that. Some of the things that are that we are trying to deal with at GURA is that a lot of the public perceives that area as being underutilized, that it is not at the highest and best economic use of the property there. We are looking at ways to expand that development and to tie into the activities around it in such a way that we do not displace the current 49 residential units there, but at the same time be able to increase the number of units that can be rented out to the elderly. We're also looking at designing something in such a way that will provide rental units at the same time some commercial space that can tie into what is happening in the surrounding area. That's our long-term goal at this point, is to address the question or the concern that it is not the highest and best use of the properties, but also to address the needs and the concerns of the current residents that they not be displaced. Okay, but that's what we're doing there, sir. The other thing that really is impeding any development of Goma Tranquilidad is that we still have a balance of $1 million in the USDA loan that was taken out back in 1980. We're halfway through that loan, but any development, any disposition or development of those properties must be approved by USDA according to the loan terms.
I mean, Madam Chair, Mr. Duenas, I certainly appreciate the comments that you provided in terms of looking at other or increasing the capacity and the number of rooms and accommodations that can be provided to our aunts and uncles. But please be very mindful, the highest and best use is all relative. If you ask me if the 49 residents have the highest best use of that Guma Tranquilidad facility today, I'm going to absolutely answer yes. If you're looking at increasing the capacity and accommodating more manamcos and senior citizens, that's a different story. So, like I said, be mindful about how you approach this, because we did have this discussion, I believe, about 12 years ago.
Again, Senator, we're trying to address the public perception. We're also concerned, and we do want to make sure that we do right by our elderly residents down there.
Thank you, Mr. Duenas, and I'm sure that we can talk offline a little bit more in detail about those perspectives. So I'd like to ask some questions in regards to the recent indictment. The first one I would have to ask, is the federal government seeking forfeiture of any federal housing funds?
At this point, before the criminal investigation was initiated, we were in discussions with HUD on how to reimburse the Section 8 program for the lease payments. And that discussion was suspended when the criminal investigation was initiated.
So is the federal government seeking forfeiture of these federal funds?
I'm not familiar with what they're doing in terms of the criminal allegation.
So the EHAB has reached you and asked you for the money that is in question from the federal government? No one?
We were before the criminal investigation was launched. We were in negotiations as to how to approach that best. And as I said, those discussions were suspended when the criminal investigation was launched.
Okay. So if it was, in fact, an avenue that you were looking at, you stated earlier that what is going on now with this, in the money that is being claimed, that was received in housing assistance program funds, a total of $379,000 roughly. How is that not immediately impacting any of the programs? Is that you have money that is already there to supplement this?
Senator, we continue to receive the housing assistance payments on a monthly basis from HUD. And then we, in turn, disperse it to the about 1,100 or so landlords to provide rental assistance to the 2,300 families. Okay. So the money continues to flow at this point. Okay.
So is the agency in need of this money, this $379,000?
The reimbursement or the restitution or reimbursement that HUD and the U.S. government is seeking is not tied into whether we need the money. It's tied in whether the question is whether the money should have been dispersed. And that's where the court case is.
Okay. In 2011, Gura had received proposals from developers interested in receiving $3.6 million in federal tax credits to build affordable housing. My question was why were credits awarded to Great Homes LLC and Tumon Heights Tower, who were the fourth and fifth ranked bidders? What was the reason behind that?
There were a couple of things wrong with your question, Senator. If this was a procurement activity, we would be awarding it to the lowest bidders, not the highest bidders. This is not a procurement activity. It was a request for proposals to develop using the low-income housing tax credits. No funds were dispersed by GURA. The tax credits were allocated to those developers, and they in turn had the responsibility to sell those units on the, to interested investors or syndicators who needed the tax credits. In terms of there was an evaluation committee that rated the five proposals that were received. In the end, the board awarded the tax credits to the fourth and fifth ranked developers. Why? It's I'm still trying to understand that myself.
Was there like a, do you have a selection criteria for these things as part of the procurement process, or perhaps you can educate us a little bit?
The selection criteria is embedded in what we call the qualified allocation plan. The qualified allocation plan spells out the types of housing we want to see built, either elderly or large families, or housing that would address needs for special populations, persons with disabilities or the homeless, and also look at ways that there were other criteria that were identified. And the developers basically fashioned a proposal to maximize the number of points that they could get. And that is how the committee evaluated and ranked, based on the number of points that they earned in terms of how they described their project. Okay. One of them would be, you got so many points just for identifying that you wanted to help 20% of families earning 50% or less of median income, or 40% of families earning 60% of area median income. We gave additional points for those who said 100% of the units would be rented out to families earning 60% of area median income. So that's how developers could look at ways to increase the number of points that they could get.
Okay, thank you. Records show, this is another question, very different from the first one. Records show that Mr. Smith was employed with GURA from April 2011 to January 2012. The question is, why was Mr. Smith allowed to continue to receive funds as a landlord despite the conflict of interest with his role as legal counsel for GURA?
At this point, Senator, this is a subject of a criminal investigation and indictment, and it would be improper for me to answer that question.
Okay, thank you. And so just to reiterate, there is nothing impacting, no immediate impact for this, the money in question that was received by Mr. Smith. No immediate impact to this, the agency, to GURA.
We will do everything we can to ensure that the housing assistance continues to flow through GURA into the community to help these families find decent, safe, and affordable housing.
Okay. And do you have a policy or process now in place to ensure that this does not happen again?
Well,
or perhaps a reviewal process?
We have, since this controversy has started, we have been developing our internal control procedures so that we can identify these potential conflicts of interest before they occur.
Okay.
We have our within our employees, we have asked employees. Let me take it one step back. A person who is a covered employee cannot, or a person is considered a covered individual, cannot participate in the Section 8 program. And basically, a covered individual is the Board of Commissioners and the officers and employees at GURA who are in a position to influence the decisions made in the Section 8 program or the policies to be adopted to benefit the Section 8 program. So,
do they sign an affidavit?
What we have, when we have new employees coming in, we do ask them to indicate whether or not they are participating in the Section 8 program as a landlord, or whether their immediate family members are mm-hmm. participating in the Section 8 program as a landlord. Immediate family members includes their spouses, their children, their in-laws, both their parents, their parents-in-laws, and the in-laws and their children. And so we've been, we have been looking at how the new employees respond. Mm-hmm. We also go ahead and run their names through the and compare it to our database of Section 8 landlords. Conflicts of interest can occur after they've been hired, or for existing employees if immediate family members become Section 8 landlords. And so we ask, we now periodically, I think every 6 months, we do send out a reminder to employees that they have a duty to disclose any potential conflict of interest because of actions of their immediate family members.
Okay. So is that, do you feel that that process is enough to protect the agency? I mean, you said that they respond, but I'm not sure. Do you have do they sign the paper verifying this?
Yes, it's basically a form they sign that indicate whether or not they have a conflict.
Okay.
Now, that's what we do every 6 months for our so. We do remind employees if they are aware of a conflict that has occurred to report that, so we can look and investigate whether or not it is in fact a conflict, whether the individual is a covered employee, a covered individual. Okay. In terms of our board of directors, our board of commissioners, when the governor's office is reviewing individuals for appointment to the board of commissioners, they do give us the name of the individual, and we do ask for the names of all their immediate family members, their spouses, their children, their in-laws as well. And we do check those names against our database of Section 8 landlords. One potential candidate gave us a list of over 20 names. Unfortunately, one name did show up mm-hmm. as participating in the Section 8 program. In that instance, we did advise the individual that if he were to continue pursuing an appointment to the board, we would probably just have to terminate that particular contract.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Duenas. Does my colleagues have any questions?
I'm sorry. Let me add one more thing.
Yes.
In terms of our procurement processes, when we procure for legal services and audit services, we do add in a question about whether or not they are covered individuals under the Section 8 program. So that's something that we've just recently added into our processing.
Thank you, sir. Senator Uggan?
Thank you very much, Madam Chair, and Mr. Duenas, thank you for responding openly to some of these inquiries. I'm surprised you don't have an attorney sitting beside you, only because of one particular area where questions are going to be posed. From what I'm hearing from you then, is that you already have a policy in place that requires each employee and each board member to identify any of the family members and identify any potential conflict of interest. Is that correct?
That's correct. Basically, with existing employees, back in January, we issued out an advisory asking them to notify us if they believe one of their family members has become a Section 8 landlord.
Okay, so that was in January. So you put out another call for more current information, but does GURA have a policy in place that would ensure potential conflict of interest does not exist or is red flagged before an issue surfaces?
Yes, sir.
You do have a policy in place?
Yes, sir. It's in our personnel rules.
Because from what I heard during the course of an interview with the media, I know that comments were made by yourself that you were formulating a policy that would ensure the conflict of interest doesn't occur. So is it, does a policy exist, or are you formulating a policy?
We are trying to refine the policy so that it's clearer to everyone. And not only do we want to, we look at the form, and we want to make sure that when an employee says, I may have a conflict of interest, that at the end, we record the final disposition of that particular disclosure statement. Right now, that is an open-ended question, and that's one of the things we're trying to do, is close that open loop so that people ask us, what did you do with this person's reported conflict disclosure, we can say this is what happened to it.
Okay, so you're highlighting the employees, and that comment also extends to board members, correct?
Board members, when they are initially identified for appointment, are vetted. That's correct. Now, current board members, those who are serving right now, do have a responsibility to disclose of any potential conflict of interest, or if they are aware that an immediate family member has become a landlord.
Okay, so board member / any employee of the agency has to be able to report. Now, my question is, okay, the onus there would be on the agency and the management, the administration of GURA. What about contractors? Do they have an obligation to, before entering into a contract with GURA, do they have an obligation to reveal any potential conflict of interest with either a board member or an employee within GURA?
Okay. That's a procurement conflict of interest question, Senator, and yes, they do have that responsibility. Employees who are involved in the procurement process at any point, either in putting together a scope of work or any soliciting quotes, do have a responsibility for disclosing any potential conflict of interest that may occur. Now, when you talk about contractors in general, the disclosure statements in place for them to sign to indicate whether or not they have a procurement conflict of interest. What I was stating earlier was for certain professions, for the services that we procure, for the legal services and for audit services, we will make it a part of the procurement package to put in a disclosure statement concerning the Section 8 program.
Okay, then a follow-on question is, let's say I'm an employee at GURA, been working there for about 15 years, and I have an immediate family member who apparently has had a business, has been operating that business successfully, rental units and whatnot for the last 10 years. The family member wants to submit a proposal. I reveal potential conflict of interest because he or she, the business owner, is a family member. Is there a process to request a waiver of any potential conflict of interest scenario? Because why would I penalize a family member if, in fact, I reveal everything, the relationship, that potential contractor or potential bidder reveals everything? Is there a process that exists where, in fact, there could be a waiver requested through the Housing and Urban Development for any of your federally funded programs?
Well, to begin with, we would have to determine whether or not that employee is involved in the procurement of that particular service or goods. Okay, and is there a waiver? I think all we can do is make sure that he is not directly involved in the procurement process.
But there's no process where an employee can request a waiver from HUD, even though he or she is not influencing the selection process.
Not in the in a procurement process. Again, the only thing we can do is make sure that individual employee is not involved in the procurement process for that particular service or goods that are being pursued.
So are you aware of any waiver that has been ever been requested?
I'm not aware of any waiver in terms of the procurement process. Okay. In the Section 8 program, landlords may request for a waiver if there is a apparent conflict of interest, but in the end, that decision is made by HUD.
Yeah.
And more often than not, it is based on the need of the family or to minimize any disruption on the families, and not so much on the landlord losing income.
Okay. And I'm asking these questions, Mr. Duenas, because it's very consistent with what the chairwoman would like to ensure the public's aware of, and that is that there's already a process, if not a process or a policy, is being formulated and updated so that, in fact, your agency under your leadership can ensure that there's no conflict of interest. If there's an appearance of conflict of interest, then obviously the onus is yours and the board members, and that there's a process in place that has to be reviewed periodically so that we protect the interests of not only those who benefit from your program, the interests of our funding source, HUD, and then also the interests of all of the employees and management, inclusive of yourself. So I really appreciate you being very upfront in responding to a number of the questions, Madam Chair. I think that the responses have clarified, at least from my perspective, that under Mr. Duenas, there are certain processes in place, certain policies in place. Perhaps what you need is a policy czar within GURA, because you deal with a lot of federal funds, so that any policies that need to be reviewed, whether quarterly or regularly, that you bring that information back to the employees, back to the contractors, back to potential contractors, and remind them that any perception of conflict of interest has to be dealt with before any process starts. So thank you very much, Mr. Duenas. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Senator Uggan. Senator Lee?
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Mr. Duenas, for joining us today. I had a couple of questions. You alluded to the Trump administration, and we've been keeping up with national news and just particularly reduction in Section 8 and maybe even a complete slashing of CDBG. We have to see what the details are in his budget proposal, but in light of those things and outside of the potential loss of federal funds due to our own recent controversies, I wanted to ask you if you could just give us specifics for how you plan or how GURA is planning for and in anticipation of potential losses from the appropriated funds that we rely on from the federal budget under the Trump administration's proposed budget. How are you planning to move the GURA programs forward and continue to realize the success and just all the services that we provide to Guam's working families, given those budget constraints?
We will be looking at ways to reduce costs. We're also looking at ways to streamline some of the processes so we do not need as many employees, but we can only reduce so much at a certain point, then our ability to administer the programs effectively will be impacted, and you know, things will take longer to process.
So you're considering reducing the amount of staff at GURA in order to, is that what I'm hearing you say?
That is part of the reality we will have to look at. We went through sequestration in 2013. Our funds were recruited or were reduced mid-year through our fiscal year period, and we had to reduce our Section 8 program by about, I believe, 8 employees. And that basically meant the remaining employees had to take up the work that those 8 employees were doing.
Okay. One additional question. And maybe this kind of goes off of what the chairwoman and Senator Uggan have previously asked, but do you have any new policies or new strategies in enforcement to prevent harms to the program and agency like that?
Well, let me remind the senators and the public, in terms of conflict of interest, the landlord or potential landlord does have that responsibility also to disclose these things. And all we're, the steps that we're taking are to ensure that if he, that individual fails to make that disclosure, that we are in a position to catch it and bring it and try and resolve those conflicts of interest up front. That's been the focus of our efforts, is the failure of a landlord or a new landlord to make that disclosure. Now, sometimes it's an honest oversight. You know, I'm not sure how many landlords are aware of what all their nephews and nieces are doing. They should be aware of whether or not their siblings are employed by GURA. But in terms of nephews and nieces and in-laws, they may not be on top of the latest developments on who's working where. So those things can occur. That's why we're asking the employees also to immediately disclose when they become aware of an immediate family member becoming a Section 8 landlord, so that we can review that conflict of interest.
Okay. And who is the current legal counsel for GURA?
Our current legal counsel is our attorney Anthony Paris, and our conflicts counsel is attorney Cynthia Ekubi.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you again, Madam Chair.
Mr. Duenas, I'd like to thank you for taking time out for this informational hearing. This is very pertinent because this essentially affects the lives and the livelihood of the people of Guam. I think it's very beneficial for them to know and clearly understand the real issue, especially with this upcoming case that is ongoing. So I'd like to thank you and all the employees at GURA for their due diligence, and also to continue to look for other avenues and new ways to implement policy to really protect the agency and the people of Guam's interest. So thank you very much for your time. I'd like to thank my colleagues for coming today and showing their equal concern about the situation that is ongoing. I'd also like to recognize Vice Speaker Senator Ted Nelson. Thank you for attending. In closing, I would like to thank all of you for being here and taking the time to participate in this informational briefing this committee has organized. A committee report will be drafted and filed as a public document with the Committee on Rules. It is now 2:52. We are now adjourned. Thank you very much.